For nearly 6,000 years, Earth's atmospheres held steady. CO2 levels barely budged until the Industrial Revolution came along. Since then, humans have released over 1.5 trillion tons of carbon dioxide into the air.
We've got to reduce emissions, which are carrying on at the moment at around 40 billion tons of carbon dioxide per year. We've got to reduce them to zero. And the only way we will get global temperatures back down again is by physically taking that carbon dioxide back out of the atmosphere.
What people don't recognize is that the oceans and the land absorb almost 50% of the emissions that we put into the atmosphere. We have these natural solutions already helping us out.
The other 50% of CO2 we emit stays in the atmosphere. That's currently nearly 800 billion tons, and it's growing by about 5% each year. This is a journey through Earth's natural carbon drawdown systems, from towering canopies to the open ocean, and everywhere in between. And it begins in the forest. Vast, intricate, and quietly working around the clock to pull carbon from the air and lock it away in trunks, roots, and soil. Nature's original carbon vault. Forests are one of nature's best known carbon sinks. Covering almost a third of the planet's surface, they are responsible for storing nearly 16 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide per year. In the US, the New England Forestry Foundation is championing exemplary forestry, a climate-smart approach designed to optimize carbon storage, strengthen biodiversity, and support sustainable timber harvests.
We can't wait 10 years to grow trees longer and store more carbon in our forests. We need to start it now. We need to start it today or tomorrow. And as soon as we start this, the bigger the impact will be. The forest is a regenerative machine. It pulls carbon out of the atmosphere, it stores it in the trees.
Their approach could boost carbon sequestration in the region by 488 million tons and could produce the region's 2050 emissions reduction goals by 20%.
We don't have to develop new technology. We simply have to make some good policy decisions. If we did this in Western Maine, it's like taking every car in Maine off the road for a century.
Just by changing how we manage forests, we can drastically increase the already drastic amounts of carbon they're able to store. As we leave behind the vast forest stores, we turn to land shaped by us. Often seen as carbon sources, agricultural land can, with the right practices, become powerful carbon sinks. Soil is more than a growing medium. It's one of the largest carbon stores on land. And with better farming practices, that potential can grow. One promising approach? A charcoal-like material called biochar.
Biochar is one way of storing carbon in soils. What we do is we take the biomass residues, the dead organic matter from agricultural processes or from managing woodlands, and we actually pyrolyze them, we burn them in a low oxygen environment to form a product which is a bit like charcoal. That biochar can be ploughed into the ground and that can actually improve soil quality as well as storing carbon. One of the really interesting questions about biochar is how durable it is as a carbon store. We know that it locks up carbon from the biomass it's made from, but a part of that might leach out into the soils and maybe get back out into the atmosphere again. We do think, though, that biochar done well has a component of carbon that can last for centuries or even thousands of years.
Theoretically, if the total amount of crop residue generated by agriculture globally were converted into biochar, it would sequester a maximum of 1 billion metric tons of carbon annually. 3/4 of that would remain sequestered after 100 years, which represents enough to offset about 80% of all greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture. From cultivated fields, we shift to wetlands. Waterlogged lands that store vast amount of carbon for centuries. Restoring these ecosystems is key to unlocking nature's power to capture and hold carbon long term. Wetlands, including their carbon-packed cousins, peatlands, are some of the most effective natural carbon stores on Earth. Wetlands are waterlogged ecosystems that slow plants' decay and trap carbon in soil. Peatlands take it further, building thick layers of partially decomposed plants over thousands of years.
We've estimated that wetlands and peatlands around the world cover less than 5% of the land surface, but they could be responsible for capturing up to 25% of the amount of carbon that soils can store across the globe. So they are absolutely critical ecosystems.
Peatlands, which make up about half of all wetlands, are particularly powerful. In the UK alone, they store around 3.2 billion tonnes of carbon.
Peatlands are incredibly rich stores of carbon. This is carbon that has been laid down over thousands of years because the vegetation which grows on the surface of the peat dies and gets preserved by the very wet soil underneath. Now, when they're drained, they start to emit carbon dioxide. But if we restore them, we can steadily reduce those emissions and hopefully get them to a point where they're taking more CO2 out of the atmosphere.
As we move from open water towards coast, we reach the dynamic intertidal zone, a meeting point of river and sea. Mangrove forests. Found in tropical regions around the world, mangroves are among the most efficient carbon-storing ecosystems on Earth. Their dense root systems trap sediment and organic matter, storing carbon for centuries while protecting coastlines and nurturing biodiversity. In Costa Rica, OSA Conservation is restoring degraded mangrove forests, working with local communities to bring back these vital carbon sinks.
Mangroves are a great carbon sink. It's been now studied, and research shows that carbon is sequestered in the mangroves up to 4 times higher rate than you have in some tropical forests. We've been working on mangrove restoration for about 4 years now. We've been able to restore close to 50 hectares of mangrove.
It's estimated that mangroves are able to store over 700 tons of carbon per hectare. Just beyond the mangroves, waves wash over the coastline, a perfect stage for another powerful carbon process, enhanced rock weathering. Chemical weathering is a natural process where certain rocks, like olivine, react with carbon dioxide and water, forming stable minerals that lock away carbon. Project Vesta is harnessing this process by adding finely ground olivine to coastal environments. Not only could this help remove excess CO2 from the atmosphere, it may also reduce the acidity in the process.
Ocean acidification is the process of an increasing acidity of the top layer of the oceans by an increase of atmospheric CO2. So olivine in water, when it dissolves, it neutralizes the acidity. So and by reducing the acidity of the sea, there's more space for the sea to take up CO2 from the atmosphere. If we grind down the olivine to sand-sized particles to increase the reactive surface and therefore the reaction rate, and we know that it takes up CO2, it neutralizes the acidity, and therefore it takes up CO2 from the atmosphere, I think we have the potential of removing hundreds of millions of tons of CO2 by implementing the use of coastal enhanced weathering of olivine. That could even go up to billions of tons.
The minerals dissolve into seawater, but the ocean's work doesn't stop there. Beneath the surface, vast forests of kelp and seaweed are already hard at work. The beauty of seaweed and kelp is that it can draw in carbon dioxide through photosynthesis without needing land, fresh water, or fertilizer.
Seaweed is very effective at storing carbon because it grows faster than any plant, so it takes up carbon incredibly quickly. And any seaweed that breaks off and sinks to the sediment locks up that carbon for a very long time if it sinks to the ocean floor.
Kelp alone is estimated to sequester 4.9 million tons of carbon from the atmosphere every year. Around the world, new uses are emerging for this remarkable carbon-capturing crop. In Scotland, Atlantic Mariculture is exploring how kelp farming to produce products such as natural fertilizer can sequester carbon while creating jobs and improving marine habitats. And in the Philippines, Coast4C are working with local communities to farm seaweed to stabilize local economies at the same time as storing carbon. And deeper still lies the ocean, our planet's greatest carbon sink, silently capturing carbon on a scale no other system can match. What is it about the ocean that has led to the United Nations to call it our greatest ally against climate change? Well, it doesn't just generate 50% of all the oxygen we need, it also absorbs 30% of all CO2 emissions, making it the world's largest carbon sink. Ocean-based carbon capture builds on processes that already exist in nature. CO2 dissolves in seawater and reacts to form carbonic acid, while phytoplankton absorb CO2 through photosynthesis. Man-made processes can enhance this miraculous feat of nature. LA-based startup Aquatic uses subtle shifts in seawater chemistry to speed up natural carbon removal without harming marine ecosystems.
What Aquatic is based on is actually just leveraging a very large natural system and providing a synthetic intervention to it.
The same chemistry as what nature does, only 99,000 times faster.
They're piloting a technology that uses electrolysis to draw carbon from seawater and turn it into minerals, storing it away for thousands of years. From the dense canopy of forest to the seagrass meadows beneath the waves, nature has shown us how to store carbon efficiently and at scale. But even nature has its limits. To meet climate goals, we'll need every tool available, including human innovation. Nature has led the way, but it can't carry this burden alone.
So, meeting our climate goals is all about what do we do with that excess. Carbon capture is the process of capturing the carbon dioxide either from the air or from a source of carbon dioxide where it's being generated from a chimney of a power station or refinery, purifying it, compressing it, and then re-injecting it back underground. And it will then stay there because once it's compressed and injected deep enough, it's under sufficient pressure that it remains in that form and doesn't leak out again.
These technologies aren't a silver bullet, but alongside nature, they're becoming a powerful tool in our carbon arsenal. If we protect and restore these living systems, they'll protect us in return. The solutions are here. We just need to scale them. Let's work with nature, not against it.